Behind the scene, with these words, I object to the incorporation of the clauses. Assembly now. Mr. Deputy, some said that the budget is terribly important. It can be very controversial in some civilized assemblies. The executive will be discussing with the legislature to engage in dialogue. Like Mr. James Dean said, maybe we cannot achieve 100% consensus, but when it is presented to the council, if there is some consultation, it would have been a lot easier. Mr. Deputy, you must be aware that you have meeting with the administration every single week, and the administration is not respectful of the council, and there are councillors who are at the beck and call of the administration. I heard the other day that there was a member who said that he would vote against the proposal, and the government will be very fearful of that. We have to look at the operation of the council. Some members refer to Germany. The report will be submitted to the House Committee on Friday, Mr. Deputy. In Germany, they have so many different parties in their own legislature, and they spend so much time trying to reach a compromise and reach a consensus. So nobody will win it all, and nobody will lose it all either. Why is it that the administration of Beijing will never learn? Mr. Deputy, there are many members who would advance many different views. Some are collective views, and a lot of them, the majority of them, will not be accepted. That's precisely the reason why we have to move amendments. You may call this filibuster, but this is allowed under the rules of procedure. I agree with some members that this is not reported in the media at all, and some would ask us what we are debating in the council. Things may start off being interesting, but after a while it will cease to be interesting. We're doing something that the rules of procedure will allow us to do.
The thing is, how should Hong Kong focus on the pressing issues? Of course, we can't focus our attention because we have all these going on. Of course, Hong Kong is said to have lost to Shenzhen, and I think Hong Kong will lose further if this goes on. Just now at the establishment subcommittee meeting, some members said we are not tier one cities. I don't know what tier we belong to. It doesn't matter what tier we belong to, but we hope that the administration will listen to society. Whether it be the budget, the policy address, or other policies, other funding proposals that you put forward, we would hope that you would discuss with members first and get the majority support of members before you properly propose them. But it's not like this. This happened this morning, and then by Friday, we would revisit the issue of Liantang boundary crossing. You think we like this? You think we like to involve in arguments and disputes with you? It's because we can't swallow it. It's not just in the council, but also outside. However, the administration will not budge. You will not want to find a consensus and a compromise with members. And you are riding roughshod over members. I have just looked at the agenda for Friday's FC meeting. There is just one item, and that is Liantang and Hong Yun Wai. And I was asking the chairman of the FC for the backlog of items, but you have included only one for Friday. Why don't you talk to members how we should go about our business? So, Chairman, if the relationship between the executive and the legislature will reach 0 degrees, well, people say we can always go down even further. And who is to be harmed? CY Leung said we should talk to Beijing officials. What would happen after the constitutional package is vetoed? Well, just look at the present moment and you know what will happen. I believe the relationship will just get worse if the package is vetoed. But the administration and the executive has never done anything to express a willingness to talk to the Legislative Council vis-a-vis important public policies for Hong Kong. You have not tried to find solutions together with the Council. The same goes for the budget and items going to the Finance Committee. Every time you enrage us. And if this is the way you work, such phenomena will just go on. That is why some members are saying they will not run again for membership. The public are also angry, and we also find this quite frustrating. Mr. Deputy, I hope you and your camp will talk to the administration and Beijing so they will find a way to deal with this situation in Hong Kong and in council where there is a wedge driven between people and Hong Kong will lose out. And CY Leung has to be held responsible for this. Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Albert Chan? Mr. Deputy, there are too few in the chamber. Can I get a quorum call, please?
還有哪位議員想發言?
Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Leung Kwok-hung. I thought I have to order the President, Jasper Zhang, not to return today. I say this because it will be a waste of time if we are to abort the meeting. Now, Wong Kwok-hung is a big mouth. Now, he's saying that there has been a blockage. And therefore, 12 motion debates have been prevented from being moved, and also another 36 oral questions. Mr. Deputy, you know that we are just going through the motion. Well, it is sort of like the large table of dishes serving the Empress Dowager. She could never reach any dish beyond the 2-foot radius. So just there for window dressing. Please come back to the topic. It is important, it is meaningful, because we are talking about those heads standing part of the schedule. Mr. Deputy, allow me to say this. If members like to have meetings very much, then come back during the summer recess so that we can have the motion debates and the oral questions. I don't mind. So it is being hypocritical. Now, Lam Tai Fai is getting worried. I'm saying that the others are hypocritical, but Mr. Lam Tai Fai is being honest and frank. What is so comprehensive power? Now, members are saying that any time beyond 1st of July should be recess and no one should come back for a meeting. Now, come back to the debate. Now, for head 60, subhead 7. Now, in fact, nobody knew much about it until the president gave us a lecture on that. The FS has done something about it. He has played a trick. He's saying that probably the airport authority is not going to pay out the dividends, and so he has to make provisions. That is, in the absence of $5 billion, he has to fund it from somewhere else. I'm against it. This is because lawmakers, including Wong Kwok-hung, aren't really fully awake. In fact, they don't even know that it is there. So in a very muddled way, they are going to endorse it. In fact, I am watching the public coffers on your behalf. The government is saying that we can't move a motion to impact upon the revenue of the government. But then the government can easily throw $5 billion down the drain. We are all lawmakers. Now, Wong Kwok-hung is saying that what is important is not important. But then we're talking about $100 billion or more. And while we're dozing off, the money will be committed. Mr. Deputy, why aren't we collecting the dividend? It is not justified. It hasn't been argued on, and in fact, when John Zhang was having a gag show, he would not be explaining the matter. Now, the money is there for us to collect, and yet the government's not going to receive it. What is worse is that the consequence is very serious for us to forget about the revenue, because in 10 years down the road, it will be $50 billion. Moreover, it has been assumed that in future, we have to approve the AA for increasing the fees. That would require the government's approval. So it seems that we have been rendered non-existent. Just now, Dr. KK Kwok said that some elderly people were stripped naked on the platform, on the podium, and then they were like animals being herded into the bathroom. Well, for $5 billion, if you use the money to improve the workplace scheme, you will be doing a good job. So how come that we are not supposed to have a debate about it? For the opportunity cost, Should we spend the money on the third runway, which we don't know whether it's going to help us? It will also increase greatly our public expenditure, and it will also cause the bunching together of infrastructural projects, resulting in inflation. Now, we are talking about the public finance and we are talking about economics. One key concept would be opportunity cost. Now, for our FS, I think he's just like a singer. The other day, the Hong Kong JA was having their annual ball, and then he was just putting up a talk show. We should address such problems. We are running out of money, and yet we are not going to collect what is due to us, and we are not going to use that money to improve the livelihood of the poor. Therefore, I have to say that I am not going to support this particular head. That is head 60 bracket 7. Now, some have argued that long hair has been filibustering, and so there has been the backlog of items. I think John Zhang should be sort of criticized for telling a lie. Now, Deputy, you have been talking to the President about the conduct of the meetings. The President has already curtailed the filibustering, so we are simply here going through the motion because we know for sure that before end of May, this will be finished. And yet John Zhang is speaking with his eyes open and telling us a lie, that is the government's running out of money. And then the UGC institutions have to dig into their reserves. Well, in fact, reserves are reserves, and they are there for emergency situations. If you have got $1 million in your bank account, a robber is holding a gun at your temple, and then I'm sure you're going to withdraw $900,000 for the robber, hand it over to the robber. So the reserves are there for contingency. Now, on the 1st of June, we know that the money will be reimbursed. So he's still telling a lie with eyes open, and he's persuading us not to filibuster. So it's a lie after a lie after a lie after another lie. It's excusable if you have a slip of tongue. So it is bad to have a lie after a lie. If you have another lie after those lies, then it's even worse. It's really mean. I haven't seen any secretary of department twisting the logic and distorting the truth. So I have to say that he should be denied his pay. Now, Wong Kwok-hung has also said that what we are doing will mean that many people will not get the money they need to spend. I think he must be an idiot. Now, I want the government to put up $50 million. Now, the government is not using it. So, we have already asked for the $50 billion to be set aside. The money was supposed to be spent on the voluntary health insurance. Now, we have just blasted open the door, and so we should just go in and take out the $50 billion. What is my purpose? For the time being, I have this single purpose. Of course, later on there are others. My purpose here is to get universal retirement protection. So it is not going to benefit others. It is not going to benefit the elders who are being treated like animals in Taipo. I think if everybody has got $3,200, even if we just pay the care and attention home $3,200, then I'm sure the treatment would have been better. So he knows very well that why I am trying to work for, and yet he's going to dismiss it, he's going to deny it. So it must be very wrong for him to do so. And he is fabricating the story. It is said that filibustering is meaningless and we achieve nothing. I must sort of refresh your memory. In year 2008, Donald Zhang in the old electrical building said that the OH allowance should be increased to $1,050 from a small sum. But then he said the government was poor and so the elders should go through the means testing. I bought a few kinds of fruits and then I hurled a few bananas at Donald Zhang. At the time we got this Tam Yu Zhong, he rose up and said that, God forbid, and as a result, after my hurling of bananas, the government dispensed with means testing. So whether something should be allowed to stand part of the schedule or not, I think this is an art, Mr. Deputy. In the year 2011, Lee Si Bong, John Zhang, followed what he did in 2007. He would like to hand out the candies, the sweeteners to us. He would like to deposit the money into the MPF accounts. He would like to do what has been done in 2007. And I was holding up a extra size check and I was evicted. Now, he would like to do this again. Of course, I had to throw something at him and I threw some Hail Bank notes at him. Now, I think we should have told him together. At that time, Chen Kam Lam said that it was acceptable. And after having criticized him, then everybody became aware that it's totally unacceptable. And they said that we should just criticize the government like what Tam Yu Zhong had said.
John Zhang said that things could be changed and each and every one of us got $6,000. So there is one has to be skillful in making things happen. For you to say that I've always been so destructive is wrong. Who has to get up early to have a photo taken with John Zhang and to celebrate the victory? We didn't have the $50 billion fund. Every time I talk about these clauses, standing parts of the bill would make people very confused. The OALA, we talked ourselves hoarse, and for no rhyme or reason, it was endorsed. And Professor Nelson Chow in 2013 was commissioned to conduct a study on universal retirement protection. Now, there were 32 oral questions and there are a dozen or so motion debates. I doubt whether they would be of any help. Mr. Deputy, are they all that effective? Can you cite any examples? After a motion debate, the administration would say that we've got a message, we're going to do it. The same can be said about the oral question. Mr. Lau Kong Wah, the Undersecretary, must be only too aware of that. Mr. Deputy, you keep saying that the administration has already answered the question. If you're not happy, you can take it up on another platform. All these words will not make any sense. I did stand up to tell Mrs. Rita Fan that Michael Soon was really filibustering, and eventually I got chucked out. So what Mr. Wong is looking at, I don't think you should be smiling. Chairman, it is right not to make it stand part of head 60 sub head 7. Mr. Deputy, I request a quorum call.
Does
any other member wish to speak? If not, I will ask the officials to speak. Mr. Albert Chan. Mr. Chairman, sorry, I did not hear you very clearly just now. Chairman, with regard to the incorporation of the heads in the schedule, of course, the majority of members will insist that they will support this. But allow me to explain a little more. If we can succeed in in preventing them from standing part of the schedule, and I'd like to explain why it is important. Some other members criticized me and they actually named me, or else I wouldn't dwell on this. They said that we were just trying to create trouble. Remember when the Kuomintang ruled China, the CCP staged many strikes and revolts and political movements because of livelihood issues under the rule of Kuomintang. In every struggle, the CCP pointed out the wrong policies of the government causing hardship to the people. The amendments that we have proposed are such that we are staging a literary struggle, a nonviolent struggle, just like what the CCP did in a violent manner. We wanted to show why policies were wrong. I spoke a lot on that in the last debate, but let me just recapitulate a little. If we could prevent Head 122 from standing part of the schedule, which is the Hong Kong police force, that would make many people happy. It would be a big thing and many people would be happy. Talking about unreasonable arrest of the mentally handicapped person, that was widely reported, and this shows that in enforcing the law, the police have shown no regard for basic human rights, that people would have different abilities, they would have different knowledge, but then as a force that uses public power, you should have basic respect for people. But from that incident, we could see that some frontline police officers used all the authority they had. I criticized many times in the past that the Hong Kong police are worse than the public security officials on the mainland. They were just like the city management teams. Judging from how they handled this mentally handicapped person, we could see that Hong Kong frontline police officers are just like city management teams on the mainland. As legislators, as people of Hong Kong, are you still happy with Head 122 allowing the police to make use of our hard-earned money to discharge the duties on a city management team level? Of course, you won't want that. As a legislator, when you scrutinize this issue, well, remember, we proposed some amendments and we wanted to go to the nature of the issues. Of course, some people are very used to being complimented, that they would always be hailed by people, and therefore once they hear something that is negative, that is a kind of criticism against themselves, they cannot accept it. I remember many years ago when Donald Zhang was the CS for A, it was in early 2000, I told him that Tin Shui Wai residents are in dire straits, and then he said, come on big boy, don't try to scaremonger. And then 3 months later, a mother jumped to her death together with her two children. Very often, you who are the powers that be, who would pay $20,000 to $60,000 for a bottle of Lafitte, and you also have your private jets and private launches, you are not with the people. It's just like the Security Bureau officials. They stay within their own circle and they get all positive reports only. It's just like the liaison office who will be drinking fine wine and Mao Tai and have a luxurious life. They only read Wen Wei Pao and Taikong Pao, and they are not with the people. And of course, all the other newspapers are also praising them. I think the investigative journalistic report of Ming Pao yesterday is quite rare nowadays, and it shows the deep-seated conflicts in our society, as Mr. Wen Jiabao said many times. From the times of C.H. Tung to Donald Zhang to C.Y. Leung, did any of them tackle deep-seated conflicts? And you, the pro-establishment camp, you are the very close to the powers that be. You would only write false reports in order to cover up and smear others and shirk responsibility. The Occupy movement was described as being supported by the U.S. behind the scenes. And also Head 21, I must object to it. This is expenditure for the CE's office. I met the U.S. congressman. We said at the end, look, you are going to see C.Y. Leung this afternoon. Ask him for evidence that the U.S. government or U.S. parties were behind the Occupy movement. And if he could not give you the evidence, tell him to shut up. And the congressman said he wouldn't use that statement. And then another congressman said, I wouldn't say it myself, but I would tell the CE that you said it. And of course, it ended with a smile of humor. So, Mr. Deputy, in the end, the U.S. congressman asked C.Y. Leung that question, and he only grinned. It's just like Aquino 3 of the Philippines. When 689 met people of power, he would only bring shame to Hong Kong. And therefore, I also object to Head 21. We have good reasons for preventing them from standing part of the schedule. Whether you subscribe to our reasons, whether you think our reasons are sufficient, is up to you to judge. But if you make a broad brush statement saying that all the amendments we propose are just there to create trouble, then you are just like the Kuomintang, who was challenged by the Chinese Communist Party. Kuomintang neglected the criticism from the CCP and the problems CCP exposed. And you also totally brushed aside the deep-seated conflicts mentioned by Mr. Wen Jiabao. In fact, many amendments, Mr. Deputy, and also our objection to having these heads in the schedule go to show and reflect the deep-seated conflicts in society. We are saying that these conflicts must be tackled. We are talking about public expenditure and public finances. These decisions of this nature reflect our values. We want to know whether public expenditure is well spent, whether we are using public money to resolve deep-seated conflicts in society. This is a very meaningful exercise. Therefore, if you unreservedly press the bell to say yes to all proposals from the executive, then you are negligent of the objective phenomena. We don't have a quorum, Mr. Deputy. I ask for a quorum count.
Wai-yip, you.
Mr. Obi-chan. Thank you, Mr. Deputy. Well, it is always at the 13th minute that we form a quorum again. I've said that why I would like to object to the incorporation of Head 62. If I dwell on telling you that I'm objecting to it, it is like talking to the wall. I would like to cite Rule 54 that we should now adjourn. Mr. Obi-chan has moved a motion to adjourn the meeting, so therefore I would like to put the question to you that is the meeting do now adjourn in relation to 45. This is a motion that cannot be amended. Administration, would you like to speak? Does any member wish to speak, Mr. Bichem? I'm now moving an adjournment. Of course.